Hi! This video will cover the FPGA implementation of an ALU shifter like that which is used in the VR4300 processor in Nintendo 64. A shifter is generally fairly simple to implement in HDL. However, the VR4300's shifter is more complex given that the floating point computation and integer computation data paths are combined. I would like to begin by mentioning that we do not need to consider the shifter implementation for a PlayStation 2, unlike in the previous videos. This is because, unlike with the N64, the PlayStation 2 only supported single precision floating point and only supported round towards zero, which is effectively truncation. Essentially, implementations beyond a standard integer shifter are irrelevant, and the shifters used within the PlayStation 2 can be reduced further from 32 bits down to a width of 25 bits. These points should be kept in mind when looking at the implemented results. With those points out of the way, let's start off with a brief overview of what an ALU shifter is. Basically, it's a device which takes input bits from A and can slide them left or right, producing the result R, based on a shift amount input. Most architectures specify three main types of shifts. These are the shift left logical, or SLL, shift right logical, SRL, and the shift right arithmetic. The reason why a shift left arithmetic is not included is because it would be identical to a shift left logical. If we take the example input 1101 and apply each of the operations with a shift amount of 1 or 1 bit, then we obtain the following results. For shift left logical, the bits are shifted left, as 0 takes the place of the least significant bit and the most significant bit falls off the end. Similarly, shift right logical works the same way except towards the right. Shift right arithmetic, however, shifts a 1 into the most significant bit instead of a 0, which is due to the fact that the most significant bit of the A input was 1. There are many use cases for these operations, however, the most apparent is integer multiplication and division by 2, where shift left logical represents a multiplication by 2, and shift right represents a division by 2. For the binary example, the unsigned and signed integer numbers are represented, with the original input being 13 or minus 3. A multiplication by 2 results in a 10, which is actually a 26, but the most significant bit fell off the end, and a negative 6. For division, on the other hand, we can see that the shift right logical represents an unsigned division by 2, and shift right arithmetic a signed division by 2. Note that 13 divided by 2 rounded down is 6, and minus 3 divided by 2 rounded down is minus 2. Hopefully this example makes sense. The MIPS3 instruction set defines 15 shift operations. We have 6 32-bit operations and 9 64-bit operations. Out of these, the top 9 are fixed value shifts, which take a 5-bit shift amount encoded in the instruction itself. The bottom 6 are variable value shifts, which take a register value as the shift amount. Since there are only 5 bits to encode the shift amount in the fixed value shifts, the DS32 instructions are added, which sets the 6th bit to 1, whereas the other fixed shift instructions set the 6th bit to 0. Additionally, since all of the 15 instructions reduce to one of the three basic shift types, only differing by how to deal with the sign extension and how to form the shift amount, we can simplify all the operations into a single 64-bit shifter component with a 6-bit shift amount. We could go into different RTL implementation strategies for shifters. However, you are almost always better off letting the synthesizer construct the shifter for you. This allows the synthesizer to optimize the implementation for the target hardware, where many devices have specific paths for implementing shifters. Here's a snippet of how I implemented the shifter part in VHDL. The second line, which implements the shift left arithmetic, is not necessary, but both the Altera and Xilinx synthesizers optimize it away since it is functionally equivalent to a shift left logical. The actual STD logic-based shifter that I will be using is a modified version of the above, which combines both the shift right logical and shift right arithmetic operations in one by selecting the appropriate shift in bit via the operation value. This results in fewer resources used, since the implementation has one left shifter and one right shifter. Now that that is out of the way, we can get into the additional functionality required by the shifter due to the combined integer and floating point data paths. You may recall the process for adding two floating point numbers together from the video on an efficient leading zero counter. In that video, I gave the example of 8.1 times 10 to the 5 plus 1.9 times 10 to the 5. We must first denormalize the numbers by aligning both exponents to the power 5 or 2 to the 17 in binary. Then we can add the numbers and renormalize the result. and the renormalization shift amount was a function of the leading zero count. All this can easily be accomplished using the previously described shifter with an additional source for the shift amount. However, an issue arises when you consider the fact that a floating point number still has a finite number of bits. Take, for example, the case of 0.9, which can be stored as the following. Note that the actual stored value is not 0.9, but a slightly off value. Now let's see what happens if we try to store it in a 64-bit floating point number. The result in this case is closer to 0.9, but is still not exactly 0.9. In fact, if you look closely, you might see something similar between the two. They both contain the repeating pattern 1100, with the 64-bit floating point containing a longer sequence. This is analogous to how the value 1/3 is equivalent to 0.333 repeating. In both cases, we have to truncate the infinite series at some point. Now, imagine that instead of a value of 1.9 in the above addition example, we used a value of 0.9. which would mean that we have additional data continuing off to infinity, but we can only store 23 bits of it in the 32-bit floating point case. So then what happens to the additional bits that fall off the end after the renormalization shift? Do we ignore them, or should we use them to better approximate our representation of the number? The answer to those questions will determine what kind of rounding the floating point representation is using. The MIPS 3 instruction set defines four rounding modes specified by bits in the floating point control register number 31. They are round to nearest, which is the standard way we think of rounding, round towards zero, which will either round up or down based on the sign, and round towards either positive or negative infinity. Typical floating point implementations accomplish these different rounding techniques via GRS or guard round sticky bits. Here is a representation of a 32-bit floating point number where the mantissa is represented by 23 bits. The bit following the least significant bit, denoted by L, of the mantissa is called the guard bit. The bit that follows is called the round bit, and all of the preceding bits are called the sticky bits. In principle, the value of all of the sticky bits are ORed together to form a single value. Confusingly, I have also seen the least significant bit of the mantissa called the guard bit, leading to the bit definition shifted over. In both cases, however, the minimum of three additional bits beyond the least significant bit of the mantissa are needed to produce the correct rounding result. If we go by the GRS bits extending beyond the least significant bit, we can work out the logic equations for each rounding mode to tell us if we need to round up. The logic equations shown are using binary arithmetic, where a result of 1 means round up, while a result of 0 means truncate or round down. These equations were taken from a set of lecture notes whose citation will be in the description. So far, this doesn't seem too bad since we only need to tack on a few bits towards the least significant side and can use those to determine if we need to round up based on the rounding mode set in FCR31. You may recall from the previous slide that the sticky bits are all the bits following the round bit, which are all ORed together to produce the sticky bit value. We know that during the denormalization or renormalization stages, one mantissa will be shifted to the right, causing bits to fall off the end. Each of the bits that pass the round bit will end up contributing to the sticky value. For example, let's say we use 3 extra bits for the guard round sticky bits, and we perform a shift right by 5, then this will be the result. Here we have 5 bits that fall off the end, which need to be collected into a new sticky value, which in this case is 1. So how do we go about doing this? After doing a literature search, there appears to be two potential ways of accomplishing the sticky collection, masking and extension. The method of masking performs a mask lookup based on the shift amount. This mask is then combined using a large AND gate, which selects only the input bits that fall off the end. It is then sent to a large OR gate to compute the sticky value S. In this case, we will use a 64-bit barrel shifter for the 64-bit double word. In contrast, the method of extension relies on extending the shifter to include all potential sticky bits. For a 64-bit double word using double precision floating point, the maximum mantissa size is 53. This means that we need to extend the barrel shifter to 117 bits in total to preserve all the mantissa bits after a shift operation. We can then take the lower 53 bits of the shifter output, combine those using an OR gate to compute the sticky value. In this example, only the upper 64 bits would be connected to the resultant data path. Let's do a comparison of the synthesis results using the Altera Cyclone 5 and the Xilinx Arctic 7 FPGAs as in the previous videos. The first thing I wanted to test was the performance difference between using the STD logic shifter, denoted with STDL, and implementing a tree-based barrel shifter, denoted by tree. This was done using 32 bits since I already had a 32-bit barrel shifter written, and I didn't really want to go through the effort of expanding it to 64 bits. The STD logic shifter operation was then expanded to 64 bits for comparison with the different sticky collection methods. Recall that the three basic shifts are the only relevant implementation for the emotion engine within the PlayStation 2. The rest of the implementations are for the VR4300 and the N64. One interesting thing to note here is that the tree-based shifter uses fewer logic units, but results in a slower maximum clock speed. The reason for this is that the tree-based shifter uses the same components for left and right shifts, at the expense of each component having a longer propagation delay, whereas the STD logic implementation creates a left shifter and a right shifter, selecting the output based on the requested operation, resulting in duplicate hardware which is simpler and runs in parallel. When increasing the shifter size from 32 to 64 bits, we can see the resource usage increases and the maximum clock speed decreases, which is to be expected. So, using the STD logic-based shifter, we can see how the mask collection and extension collection implementations do. Interestingly, the resource usage is flipped for both the mask and extension implementations for the Cyclone 5 and Arctic 7, respectively. This is most likely due to performance optimizations on the Arctic 7, which can be seen in the fact that the two implementations use more than 137 registers. The extra registers are due to duplicate paths in an attempt to minimize routing delays. In both the Cyclone 5 and Arctic 7 cases, however, the mask collection method produces better speed results. These results are obtained using unoptimized implementations. We can use the fact that the double precision floating point number only contains a 53-bit mantissa to remove 11 bits from the calculation. Additionally, we can use the fact that we only need to do sticky collection on shift rights and therefore the shift left version does not need to perform sticky collection. With that said, let's see how a more optimized version does. Here we can see a comparison of both the unoptimized and the optimized implementations of the mask and extension collection methods. We can see that in both cases, the resource usage improves, and the performance of the mask collection method improves, while the extension collection performance stays the same or decreases. Interestingly, the optimized and unoptimized versions of the extension method have the same performance and resource usage for the Cyclone 5 case. Most likely, this is due to the minor optimization for removing collection on the left shifter, which Cordis may have done with the unoptimized case. Out of the two methods, the optimized mask collection implementation provides the best performance, with marginally increased resource usage on the Cyclone 5 and reduced resource usage on the Arctic 7. So that's the implementation that I will use. Note that in both cases, the minimum clock speed is above the 100 MHz target goal for the N64's VR4300. Now that the sticky shifter has been implemented and optimized, we need to look at rounding logic in more detail. Let's take the contrived example, which can occur in normal operation, of the mantissa composed entirely of 1s. Now let's assume that the GRS bits require that we round up. Doing so would mean adding 1 to the least significant bit. And now hopefully the tricky part becomes apparent. Not only do we need to implement a propagation adder for rounding up, we also need to account for the renormalization correction after rounding up, and additionally, the second renormalization must also update the exponent accordingly. A simple solution to this problem would be to pass the result of rounding back through the shifter for another renormalization step. However, the VR4300 CPU requires that all the renormalization be completed in a single cycle. To accomplish this, we could try duplicating some of the hardware to look something like this. Here we compute the rounded result with post-renormalization via a shift right logical and the regular shift result in a chain so that the correct output can be chosen by the GRS logic controller. The problem with this is that the critical path requires several components within the overall shift unit, which will slow down the maximum clock frequency. It should be noted that most dedicated floating point units will split up the rounding stage into two cycles, with one being combined with the adder and multiplier. Unfortunately, due to the combined data path, we don't have that luxury here. Here we have the optimized mask collection optimization along with the initial implementation and two optimizations for the rounding adder. One of the optimizations was to compartmentalize the adder, and the second optimization was to reduce the size of the adder to 54 bits. Overall, the implementations do decently, and all reach a maximum fmax greater than the speed of the VR4300 and the N64. I think that given the minor speedup and resource reduction, the adder reduce implementation would be the best to go with. keep in mind that the full rounder component only needs to meet the frequency requirements of the N64 and not that of the PlayStation 2, so overall I am satisfied with the final result. As mentioned previously, the only other method that I have seen to increase frequencies is to either split rounding into two steps, separated by a register, or to simplify the rounder, which would not meet the specifications of the R4300. Anyway, hopefully you found this video interesting. Thanks for watching!